Okay, so we have seen that the convolution operation, which looks kind of complicated, is something that we have been working with for a long time without actually even realizing that what we were doing is actually convolution. What about it? I mean, how does it help us move forward in terms of communication systems? So it turns out that you can actually use this theoretical description of this application of convolution in a very meaningful way if we take that this our input x of n that we have and this h of n, which is our system impulse response, if we take them as the coefficients of a polynomial in variable z. Okay, and so this is that particular polynomial in the variable z, h of k times z to the power minus k. Let us call this polynomial, when we evaluate it at a specific number z inverse, let's call it h of z. This is the definition of this polynomial. It's same as that p of x and q of x that we had seen here. P of z and q of z that we had seen here, except now we are calling it h of z. And now, for the sake of consideration, let us say that our polynomial for the input can be just represented as z of n. So x of n is nothing but z of n. It's not a summation anymore. There is no such summation going on. It's just x of n is z of n. Now let us see what happens when we do this convolution. This is our formula for the convolution. And so what we'll see is that when we do that convolution, because we can represent x of n as z of n, this x of n minus k, which is this term here, we will be able to represent that as z of n minus k. Okay, so we are simplifying this expression for the convolution in this manner. Now realize that this summation is over k, variable k, and so this z to the power n is a common variable. We can just pull it outside of this summation, and so then we get this terminology here. But now we realize that this summation of h of k times z of minus k is the one that we have earlier defined as h of z. This is the polynomial evaluated at z inverse. And so we can just simply substitute the second part of this equation with h of z. But then we see that this z of n is nothing but x of n. And so finally, what we get at the output is y of n is just x of n times h of z. So what has happened is that the output of this convolution in this case is nothing but the input x of n after it is multiplied by this possibly complex valued scalar. It may be real valued also, depending on the value of z. By the way, z can in general be real valued or complex valued, but z is a scalar, it is not a vector. And therefore this term is also a scalar, it is not a vector. X of n is also a scalar, because it is the value of input at this index of time, nth index of time. So what has happened quite miraculously is that this y of n which is this complicated convolution operation, which we have seen, it can be thought of as the product of a big H matrix with a column vector X. So this equation here required us to use matrices in vectors. Surprisingly, that has now become just the simple product of two scalars, X of N and H of Z. So for this specific input, X of N is equal to Z of N. And only for that input, this convolution operation turns into something very simple. It's just product of two numbers, two scalar numbers. And so there is something quite special about using this X of N as the input to the convolution. And so we reserve a special name to such an input. It is called the eigenfunction or eigenvector of this convolution operation. If X of N cannot be written as Z of N, then this derivation doesn't hold anymore. And then we have to go back to our matrix vector product description. But whenever X of N can be written like this, this trick works, and we are able to write Y of N as nothing but the input times H of Z. So the question becomes, is this just a mathematical trick, which is quite curious, but does it even have any real practical value? And so it turns out that it actually is quite a consequential observation that we are making here. And towards that, we'll take a specific value of this variable Z. We'll make it equal to e to the power j 2 pi f, where this f we are going to denote that as some notion of frequency in hertz. And so when we have z as e to the power j 2 pi f, x of n, which is z to the power n, just becomes e to the power j 2 pi f n, whose real component is this cosine waveform, and real imaginary component is this sine waveform. This type of input is called a discrete time complex exponential phasor, which is rotating at some frequency f, small f. The reason why this is important is because this cosine of 2 pi fn and sine of 2 pi fn are our well-known waves. They are called sinusoidal waves. For example, all the electromagnetic waves, including the radio waves that are used whenever you listen to FM radio or the AM radio, and also the radio waves over which your cell phone receives the incoming calls, and it makes outgoing calls, and the waves that get transmitted by the satellite and they reach your rooftop dish antenna, and then you get your television, or even the waves that your eyes perceive, the electromagnetic waves that make up the visible spectrum of the light, and the different colors that we see. They all are representable as this sinusoidal waveforms. And so this type of input has an immense practical utility. Now we are not talking about some mathematical tricks here. We are now talking about something serious. This is what makes up a lot of engineering systems. With this type of input, we apply the same mathematics that we had on the previous slide, and we look at what happens to the output of the convolution operation when we send such an input, x of n is z of n, z to the power n, but in this case it is also e to the power j 2 pi f n. We send that through this linear shift invariant system, LSI system, with impulse response h of n. Now, not it does not matter what h of n actually is. It can be any different impulse response. We are not restricting h of n to take a specific shape. But what is happening now is that with that with x of n represented as z of n, we go through the same derivation that we had before, except now our convolution operation will take, instead of x of n minus m, we are going to write exponential function, which is e to the power j 2 pi f times n minus m. And just like we did earlier, we are going to pull out the term here which doesn't depend on this variable of summation, which is m now. And so we are getting back the same equation that we had. What we get at the output y of n is the input complex exponential after it is multiplied by a possibly complex valued scalar h of f, which is defined as this summation here. Okay, so fine. So again, let us see the practical utility of this. And this actually will now lead us to the topic of Fourier transformation. Now to get there, let us do one more thing. We will make our input more complicated. Instead of taking x of n as just a simple complex exponential at a single frequency, we will take it to be a weighted sum of two different exponentials which are rotating at two different frequencies, and let us say that they have different weights, which we are going to call them as x1 and x2. And so our input is now this input here. Where can this arise? Well, maybe f1 corresponds to the frequency of the red color, and f2 might correspond to the frequency of green color. And maybe what we are seeing is a mixture of these two colors, where red is maybe slightly more stronger than the green. And so how much strong each individual colors are, the weights x1 and x2 represent that. And x of n is the signal that we are looking at, which is the mixture of red and green with different weights. So when we have such an input and we pass it through this linear shift invariant system, let us see what happens. This is just the formula of our convolution operation here. But now in place of x of n minus k, I am writing this expression of x of n minus k coming from here. But now I can apply the same trick that I did, but that I will do individually on each term of this summation. So when I apply that trick here, I get this term. When I apply that trick here, I get the second term. But you will see that this is nothing but h evaluated at f1, capital H evaluated at f1. This second summation is capital H evaluated at f2. And what we have pulled out is nothing but our original colors, x1 and x2. And so when we have this type of situation, what we get at the output are the input signals, x1 and x2. These input signals are combined at the output, just like the way they are combined at the input. But before combination, they get additionally weighted by h of f1 and h of f2. That is what we have observed here to be happening. Okay, maybe we will take a pause here and resume in the next video.